morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So many years ago, when I was in Korea, I studied with my spiritual mentor, and for 2 weeks straight, I would just go to her room. It was in Iksan, and we would study the principal book of Won Buddhism together, just her and I, just together in this one room. And upon looking back, I think those 2 weeks were some of the best and memorable days of my life. Whenever I entered the room, she would have some kind of fruit, some snack waiting for me on the table. And I would sit down in front of her, and her first question was always the same. Do you have any questions? So on the days that I practiced and that I studied hard, I would always have at least one question. But when I slacked off or I got caught up doing other things, I would usually have no questions to ask because I had not studied. And of course she knew all of this. And she would remind me, she said, you have to make these teachings your own. You can't just memorize what I tell you. If you don't have questions, if curiosity doesn't arise within you, you will only repeat what I say. So what she was explaining to me was that when we ask questions, we start to reveal the truth of who we are. And we start to see the universal truths of this world. But if we only accept what is given to us, the truths of the world remain hidden, dead, and lifeless. So there's a story of a monk. His name is Hyeonggak-sinim. He's actually a Westerner. He went to Yale and then Harvard, but later dropped out of school after meeting his spiritual mentor, the Korean master, Seungsan. And what caught Hyeonggak-sinim's attention was not necessarily Master Seungsan's Dharma talk. In fact, Master Seungsan spoke little English. But it was that one time he went to Harvard in the lecture room and he somehow gathered all these students together and he asked us the questions. He said, what is this? Who am I? The very Zen question, the existential question. And for some reason that just caught Hyeonggak-sinim's attention. So for us sitting here now, we may ask, what are we experiencing in this very moment? What is happening to you right now? In Won Buddhism, in the 8 articles, one of the articles is questioning, and it's an extremely essential part of our practice. Questioning means wanting to discover and know what we do not know about human affairs and universal principles, which is the motive force that reveals what we are ignorant of when we try to accomplish anything. So this wanting to discover and know is about having a deep interest, a longing to investigate, to know what's true. We want to come home to living truth, and this frees us. So my spiritual teacher, the one who I sat with and studied with when she was dying from cancer, she would sit in her room, in her chair, with her feet propped up on a stool to alleviate the pain, because her legs started to swell up. And her body was just in extreme pain, but her mind was free. And I remember sitting next to her and she said, look at my legs, because they're all swollen. And she had to take the elastic out of the sock because it was too tight. And so I started to massage her legs. And she says, you know, when you massage my legs, I know you're meaning good, but it actually hurts. But she didn't scream or push my hands away. She just said the words very calmly. And I couldn't understand it. In fact, when I went to her room before I started massaging her legs, she was sitting and studying. And I asked her, what are you studying? She goes, oh, well, it's a teaching that I received from the third Karma Dharma master. She goes, and I'm preparing for my next life. And so there she was, remaining very calm, and yet her body was in pain. And so I just thought to myself, wow, is this what inner freedom is all about? And she knew answers to certain questions. What really matters? What's really true? She had the ability to come into this exquisite presence. And these questions allow her to cut through the trance of physical suffering and brought her attention to what is real. And that was why she could be present with me as I started asking her questions. But of course, this is very difficult. It's not easy. For me, I'm still in the dark many times, bumping into things. Many times where I don't pause and I don't engage in any kind of wise inquiry. And I get lost in this pattern. Stuck in the pattern of life that is replayed over and over again. But there are moments when the inquiry starts to kick in. And there's that moment where a light shines that dispels the darkness of ignorance. And this happened to me most recently when I was driving. Some interesting things happened on the road. And I was driving home, and the bus beside me was trying to cut in, trying to get in front of me. So I decided to slow down and just allow the bus to come in front of me. And my expectation was that the driver would somehow give me a sign, like, thanks. Yeah. Like in Korea, they put the hazard light on, that's a sign of thank you. And I'm here, you know, it's giving like a wave of my hand. And I don't know why, for some reason I was like, come on, bus driver, give me a sign. I did something good for you today. And there was nothing. And so there I was waiting for the driver to give a sign, but of course he didn't. And the first thought that came to myself was, well, okay, you know, see if I do the next time for you. Never again. And then I just had to stop, and I was like, okay, whoa, what is this all about? Where is this coming from? And that moment of pausing and inquiring allowed me just to put a mirror to myself for that moment. And I could see the ego in me, of course. The ego in me that wanted to be pat on the back. The me that wanted the recognition. And then it brought me to another realization, which I feel is universal in some sense. It's that, you know, wanting love, wanting recognition, wanting praise. And so it was for me, it was a mental note to be mindful next time of when someone does something nice for me, to just remember to say thank you. And that to really express appreciation. And what I learned in that moment is, don't expect praise from others if you do something nice for them, but please make sure to appreciate others if they do something nice for you. And it reminded me of a quote from the Dharma Sutra. So pausing and inquiring is a powerful practice that many times can help us cut through ignorance, cut through moments, difficult moments, and cut through automatic responses that may actually cause harm to ourselves and others. Because many times I feel like I'm in a dreamlike state, but pausing and inquiring helps to break through that. And then you stop believing the stories that run through your head. So questioning helps us to bring what is unconscious to consciousness. It's this presence that allows the storyline to fade. It's in a natural space of kindness grows. So why is this the case? I think inquiry coupled with presence really opens us up from a limited identity. So when we pause, we stop that internal dialogue, that sense of self dissolves. There's that deep listening, that deep, sincere interest, and we step out of the perpetual movement that we're stuck in. So I was hoping that we could try this out together. And I invite you to just gently close your eyes and just take a few deep breaths and just ease into a relaxed presence. Just notice what's happening. Feel yourself here. Just feel your heart. And just sense if there's something going on in your life you're choosing something where you get reactive. You might get reactive in a situation with somebody else. You might be reactive about something going on with your body. It might be one of your addictive behaviors. And bring to mind where this is in action, where the situation is evoking in you fear or judgment or hurt, anger. Letting your attention go to where you're most stuck. And inquire, what am I believing? Are you believing you are wrong or bad? What am I feeling? Be gentle. Asking, what am I believing? And you may have beliefs like, I'm a failure, I'm never going to be happy, people will never love me. These may come quickly. If not, don't try to generate them. Just be with whatever comes up for you. Just notice this. Just rest in the intention that is inquiring. Just like the ocean attending to the waves that are moving. You may ask, who would I be if I didn't believe in this? Who would I be if I didn't believe something was wrong with me? Can you sense the glimmer of freedom? Sense who you are, the sense of your being when you're inquiring. And there's this mindful inquiry. And then simply dropping inquiry and just rest in that presence itself. So taking a few full breaths. And inviting you to open your eyes. So this genuine, sincere presence wakes us from the identification with the object. When it gets quiet, we continue and ask, who's aware? Who or what is aware right now? And just being that awareness. So this inquiry is really an inner spiritual journey, but it's also an external path to compassion and wisdom. So you may have heard the phrase in Won Buddhism about human affairs, right? Human affairs means the right and wrong, benefit and harm among human beings. So we live in a world where we are constantly in contact with people. So questioning helps us to put ourselves in the other person's shoes as well. We start asking the question, what does he or she need? What does this person need? So this is, again, an incident that happened to me a few years ago when I lived in Korea, lived in Iksan with a roommate. And you know what happens when you start living with somebody for a week? You get back to the point where you start annoying each other. Just getting on my nerves. And I was probably getting on her nerves as well. But whenever I said something to her, she would snap back at me. Right? And I started getting really irritated. And the question that naturally arose was, what's going on? Because it got to the point where we're just fighting or bickering at each other all the time. So I said, it's a pause. And I said, what is going on? And I took a deep breath. And I closed my eyes and I started going a little bit deeper into the question. And of course there was some things I did that annoyed her, but there was something else going on. And when I paused, what I began to realize was that her father was in the hospital, diagnosed with a severe case of diabetes. And as the eldest daughter, she was worried. And she felt a huge burden on her shoulders. And I asked the question, what does she need? So I went over to her side of the room and I asked her, you must be really exhausted right now. Is there anything I can do to help? And she was quiet for a while and then started to explain why she was upset. So her father was discharged from the hospital, was back home, and he has a history of drinking. And just that day he bought a bottle of the rice wine, Korean soju. And despite strict orders from the doctor, he went out and he just bought it anyway. And when she confronted him, he shouted back, I can deal with this myself. Don't tell me what to do. And so she walked out, she was furious. And she had no clue what to do. And she had no one to talk about it with. So it was interesting. I was trying to put myself in her shoes. And then when we started talking about it together, we did our best to try to put ourselves in her father's shoes. And what we realized was that he felt isolated. He was very unhappy, and it was alcohol that was his way for him to cope. And so when we started talking about that, she started opening it up. And then she made an intention. She said, okay, I'm going to go back and I'm going to ask him the same question. What does he need? What can I do to help? So we begin to sense we each need to feel loved. And our hearts get tender and we start to extend ourselves in those moments. And when there's this inner healing, we naturally bring that to others. So my wish for us here today is that together we really cultivate this true presence that allows that storyline to fade and that allows us to
to really grow that natural space of kindness. Thank you so much.
Microphone.
In the beginning, your story about the bus, I was thinking that had the bus driver waited or flashed his lights, it would have been meaningless. But the fact that he did nothing, he did a great service because he got you thinking and he became a teacher.
Yeah.
So sometimes it depends which way you approach the situation. Yeah. If you get what you want, it isn't always good for you.
Yeah. I was just trying to fed my ego more. It's like, yeah, I did another good deed today.
Yeah, those moments are your greatest teachers and teaching opportunities for practice, definitely.
Mm-hmm. So would it be rude to thank people?
Thanking people. One of the things I learned, so this is one of my habits, is that, this is another thing, is that if somebody compliments me, I push somebody say, oh, no, because you're trying to be humble. So I asked my teacher, I said, I have this, and then, but what happened one day is that somebody had complimented me, and I did that, and she got hurt. She actually got hurt. She said, I'm giving you a sincere compliment, why can't you receive it? And then I looked back and went, why can't I? And I think it's just ingrained in me. When I was young, my parents were always like, be humble. You know, I took that to the extreme. And so I asked my teacher, I said, I have this habit now. She said, what is it? I said, I don't know how to receive compliments. I think that if I receive it, I'm going to feed my ego, or that I'm not humble. And she said, one way to do this, and she said, say thank you, but share the praise, right? It's like share it, meaning thank you so much, you know. And this was, it could be an internal note to yourself, or you can say it. And you said, this was possible, not just because of me, but because of so-and-so, and because of this place, this temple, or you share the praise. So I've been practicing that. But also, receiving is also saying thank you to the person who sincerely made that compliment to you. Yeah.
Additional comments, questions?
Yeah, I wanted to thank you so much for this talk, because in talking about some of the areas of need for me and areas of challenge for me, number one, when you said about the being gracious for saying thank you for the compliments, verbatim what you said was my problem. Mm-hmm. Exactly. When I was little, it was like, be humble. You make sure you be humble, you honor us. And then I learned when I came here, it's like, well, just say thank you. Mm-hmm. And you show the gratitude for the compliment. Mm-hmm. And it also gives that energy back.
Yeah.
And so it's like that sort of seemingly small detail was a big leap. And then it sort of added to the big area for me of the human affairs, especially, because the so many areas that I see that are so simple for every other person, especially, you know, a Western American person, mm-hmm. and for me, I know I'm very ignorant. And so it's like, okay, trying to figure out, okay, what am I supposed to say? What am I supposed to do? And the only way sometimes I recognize it is when I see somebody's face and it kind of looks like, where? I'm like, okay. But sometimes it's not appropriate to ask, okay, where did I mess up? Because then that makes the person feel like they're on the spot.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just this ability to reflect mm-hmm. and ask myself and then incorporate, but then let it go so that it's not creating more stories.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So this was just, it's a great continuation of the journey,
yeah.
in my journey in that area of need for me. So thank you so much.
And I just want to emphasize the importance of that initial stop. Actually, that could be a talk in itself, but that before you inquire, that stopping is so important. Because where that inquiry is coming from is also important. If you're just inquiring from a place of total attachment or delusion, then the choice that you make is also going to be diluted. But when you stop and you really calm any kind of the emotions and just notice, okay, what am I feeling? You're tapping in to that place before that disturbance arose, and then you start inquiring from a place of clarity, then your decision, your choice is also clearer. So I was, oh, yeah, I just went to it and decided to pinpoint some bad initial stopping and pausing too. Yeah.
Thank you.
Elizabeth.
Hi, way back here.
Hi.
Thank you for that great call. So, I've been trying to practice that stopping thing. Well, everything that everybody said, it all, it's everything going on in my life. But the thing about that stopping, so yesterday, I at the end of the day, for some reason, I was just in a terrible mood. Like, everything was wrong, my life kind of. So I couldn't figure out why. I mean, some of you obviously know why. So I did some stopping and some reflection. I thought, well, it's probably because my car has something really wrong with it. And it's, you know, I'm insecure. Money, oh no, it could be. Okay, that's me. Sometimes I've discovered, sometimes stopping and reflection might not give you the answer, but I've discovered that just the act of stopping and reflecting itself, even though you don't have the answer, you still detach from whatever it was. And even though I still don't know why I was in such a horrible mood, was I expecting some praise or recognition at the end of the work week that I didn't get? Who knows? But just the stopping itself was helpful. Yeah.
It's very interesting you say that. And there's actually different levels of inquiry too. There's the inquiry that self, internal inquiry. Then there's the inquiry that you have to seek help from, inquiry from other people, seek advice. For example, for that situation, there's certain situations where you probably need, you know, more objective, more advice from other people. So that's another type of inquiry, saying, hey, there's this issue that I'm dealing with. What do you think? Or what's your opinion? So, but you're right, that initial stopping itself is just a powerful practice.
Mm-hmm.
Thank
you.
Your comment about there's not always an answer opens a whole can of worms. Because questions are always answers, a balance. So somehow it can be very uncomfortable to know that there are questions that don't have answers, at least right now. And the mind repels those kinds of questions, that they're difficult sometimes to even touch because they seem either too big or pointless if there's not some idea that there is an answer that I can get right now. And that it can be an obstacle to my questioning.
You have cases for questioning, those kind of questions, or just existential?
It could be anything, even a small question that if I don't have a sense that there's an answer now, waste or scary, or it's just that idea of question answers so tightly.
Yeah.
Coupled, if it's not right there, there's some sense of answer. Mm-hmm. Question is a problem.
Mm-hmm. That could cause anxiety for somebody. Definitely.
Yeah, it's in touching. That just touched off something that, you know, in my own work consulting, that this person I was working with. There's, you know, it's a young medical student, and this question of letting go at that moment. Well, number one, it seems like first we need to understand that there's a need to question, you know, to stop, to even be aware of, like, when that occurs. And then, you know, in working with him, it was like this, and I see this in myself, what you're just saying, in terms of not knowing and letting go, and the fear in that space of, like, trusting that if you stop and let go, that something can be present there that you don't need to know, and be able to be in that kind of openness, and being able to trust that. So I've seen the importance of that in my own life. And I also saw what you were saying before, and what other people were saying about the difficulty in being humble at that moment. You know, it's like there was this one place where this young man said that, like, he thanked me, and it was really hard for me like even take that in. And I'm not so sure it's just a matter of the humbleness. I think there's a certain part of me that has difficulty accepting that I can be good, that I really own this work, that I really, you know, there's a part of me that doesn't feel like I'm good enough to receive that, and doesn't trust myself, or doesn't believe, you know, like, there's some wounding there that goes so deep that I can't trust myself, or I can't believe in myself, or even affirm myself. That makes it very hard for me to receive a compliment. So it's multi-layered. It's also there, you know, there's a little bit of this humility thing. And not like not wanting to be egocentric, but there's also a deeper layer for me of this place of not really trusting myself or believing in myself or being able to let go. And it does tie into that fear of like wanting to control and not knowing and being willing to accept that I don't need to know or that I can open to that space and feel the connection. So I'm working with those kinds of things that I struggle with.
This powerful conversation because even as you know, last year I was in the limbo state of what I'm going to do now, and I'm doing it, and I'm going through a major wave of 4 projects needing to finish at the same time in a couple of weeks. And so yesterday, you know, I sent an email Wednesday saying I need this for all 4 projects in order to proceed, and it's still yesterday I'm like scrambling through all the different people I need this information of, you know, and they give me information and I'm like questioning now, like, is this correct? Am I going to waste my time because it seems wrong? So I'm going back to them and for some reason I felt that urge of blowing off. I say, so instead I just called them and we had conference calls. I was on the phone all day yesterday and we resolved them. But one by one, enough that I have my team working on at least half the things. So, but it's amazing how it stopped. I didn't know that art before.
Thank you, Reverend. I was thinking about. When I was young, I grew up in the Catholic Church, and I used to resent going 5 minutes down the road to the church because it didn't do anything for me. And that's not a reflection of the Catholic Church itself, just from my personal view. And it's talks like this that I really caused me to ponder and think and reflect, and just the intelligence of it. And it's interesting because I was thinking about this probably since I've been here 4 or 5 years. I probably had, this is a guess, but 20 to 25 friends or family that have come and visited the temple. And I was thinking about it, not one of them did I ever say, you should come to the temple. They came just because they saw what I could have. It's weird, it actually gets to me a little bit, because it's just like I said, talks like that really, really hit me and made me think and made me reflect and made me be grateful. And like I said, people around me just said, huh, why is he so happy? You know? So, just a comment. I really enjoyed the talk, and it did actually get me like thinking about how thankful I am, you know, to be here.
I'm so happy to be here for this community. Seriously, I'm very grateful. Like, if you can't reach Buddha by yourself, like if I had no Dharma friends,
And the fact that sometimes we don't have all the answers, but we're trying. And then even when I sit in the morning with the cases of questioning, you don't get the answer right away. It's not supposed to, you're not supposed to get it through a logical way of thinking. But there, it's like that belief that in the moment that somehow maybe you will have a small awakening at some point, and I'm going to keep trying to see who I truly am. And that goes back to what you were saying, Barry. There are moments when I also don't, you're absolutely right. And you know, I can't accept comments because I don't trust myself. And you start to realize the labels that you create about yourself. Like, I'm not a good such and such. I am not. So when they say that, but no, but I believe I'm not. And then, but then that's not truly understanding who I truly am. It's like I'm neither this nor that. I can't label myself. But because I did, you know. So thank you for that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.